Now, you can create a trust using either this wizard. If you choose New Trust, by default, you're going to get that wizard. Actually, you're going to get whatever's selected here. You can either choose Wizard or Advanced. So you can choose a wizard, and it'll step you one by one screen through that. Or if you choose Advanced, then at that point, whenever you do a new trust at this point, it's going to bring up that Advanced, in which you can see everything at once. Now, for the sake of this demonstration, I'd like to show you, not with the wizard, I want to show you the Advanced method. And the reason is because we'll be able to go line by line here and explain each and every one of these things all on the same screen. So the trust name is just arbitrary. New test trust is a fine name for a trust. Obviously, you'd like to have something that reminds you what it is. We can have a description. Now, of course, the server name is going to be whatever server you're allowing access to. In this case, this is our Pi home node. Now, when it comes to this section right here, IP information, you can either specify a computer name, a fully qualified domain name, or even just a local name. So for example, I could do this, myserver.mycompany.com. Now, if you're going to use this network path, you are going to have to make sure that your server has the ability to do a DNS lookup, that's a domain name server lookup, so that when the connecting client passes its IP address, it can convert that IP address into that network path. Now, it's for that reason, because that DNS lookup tends to slow things down a little bit, I don't see this being recommended a great deal. Typically, what we've been suggesting over the years is, no, instead of doing it like that, you just use hard-coded IP addresses. It's generally a good rule of thumb to keep those IP addresses hard-coded on these interface nodes. Now, when it comes to this netmask field, you're generally safe in putting 255 in all five octets. What we're doing here is the same type of logical anding or netmasking that you would do in a routing table. So if you're familiar with that issue, you can do all the nice, you know, cool things you may be familiar with to give yourself a whole range of allowed IP addresses. Now, 255 in all octets means it's only going to allow this first one. Here's a little calculator I found just searching for network calculator, and it helps explain what's going on here. See, if I have, let's imagine that this is my IP address, my incoming IP address coming from the client, and this is the netmask I choose. As you can see, if you choose 255, the allowable address range is this huge range here. Actually, it's no range at all. It's just from that number to this number, which is the same number. It's basically going to allow one connection. See, one connection. If I were to change that to 254, it would allow exactly two connections from 204 to 205. If you were to change this to, I think it's 240, now we're up to 16 connections. Look at the range of the connections, 192, 168, 70, 192 to 207. So this whole little sub, I don't want to call it a subnet, but this range here from 192 to 207, including this one, are going to be allowed. Wasn't that great? You have this mechanism to use this tremendously complex netmasking system to do the same thing as just creating 16 trusts. See, there's no difference in what you're doing right here. If you were to use this and a netmask of 240, if you were to go in here and choose, let me go back into my server here, and choose a netmask of 240, then that means you're basically allowing everything from, oh, what was it again? Everything from 192 to 207 to get access. And that's great. That's fine. But you know what you could have also done? You could have also just created 16 trusts, you know, 192, 193, 194. Now, of course, that's not a very elegant solution to just, you know, make 16 trusts starting from 192 and going to 207 and putting 255 in all four octets. But it saves you the trouble of having to learn the netmasking logic or going out and finding your own calculator. And I've talked to the development team, and it doesn't add in really any overhead. So if you're not, you know, a netmasking wizard who, you know, does this stuff in their sleep, then feel free, if you do have a range of IP addresses you want to allow, feel free to just go ahead and do it by creating multiple trusts. Now, that's, you know, that's very rare that you're going to see somebody that needs to do that. But hey, it's in the software. I feel obliged to explain it to you. And so I think it's sufficient to say for almost all purposes, you're simply going to use 255 in all octets. And if you do need a range, you know, it's probably not going to be more than a couple of IP addresses. Just create a couple of trusts. I mean, anything else you do, you're gambling that the next guy that has to manage this knows net masking logic to the same degree you do. Yeah, now I'm sorry, I don't want to denigrate this feature. It's a great feature and it's very robust. It's just that it's probably not something you're going to require. Okay, so having done these two things right here, specifying the IP address and netmask, now I've created one of those, you know, fairly bad trusts, because all we're saying is anybody that comes from that incoming connection, no matter what their application name is, they're going to be able to do whatever they want, you know, whatever this identity has permission to do. So at this point, if you want, you can add an application name, and that's typically what happens for interfaces. Let's say, for example, this is an interface that's SDK-based, and it's for this buffering subsystem. The buffering subsystem is called pybuffss.exe. That would effectively allow just the buffering subsystem located on this computer to write, and that's what we want. Now, we typically do not associate Windows account information with this. This is not where we're going to be. We're not usually using Windows domain or account information with trusts. Trusts are generally for unattended applications. And unattended applications, you know, well, for the most part, they're API-based, and this information is not going to be available. So it's something you can generally ignore. Now, the last part of this is you need to specify the identity that this is associated with. Now, I'm pretty sure some of you are going to be going in and taking a look at your existing system. I would not be surprised if some of you didn't see this. This was kind of the first step that many people take in just getting things to work. See, because PyAdmin is the super user within the Py system. And PyAdmin can certainly write to anything on that Py server. So if you grant this incoming connection PyAdmin privileges, that's pretty heavy-duty privileges. He'll certainly be able to do everything. So we see this in testing. Somebody's testing an interface for the first time. They haven't gone to the trouble of configuring security properly yet, so they go ahead and use PyAdmin. Now, after you do that, go one step further and actually create a user who's the proper user who has permission just to write to the things that this application needs to write to. So let me give you an example. Let's pretend this is coming from a different server, 202 in this case. I'll do this so that I can save it. And what was this called? This was called my2trust. Let me get rid of my bad trust. Just confuse the issue here. Yeah, here's my new trust. So let's say we've done this just for the purposes of testing. We got it all working and it looks good. Now at that point, you need to lock this trust down so that it's not giving PyAdmin privileges. No, instead you need a user who has permission to write to the tags associated with this buffering system. So for example, in the case of my example here, if I look at all the points that are currently configured, I'll go ahead and do a search for this, all the points currently configured to bring in data from the OPC interface, if I take a look at that, there we go, there's actually only one of them. And I take a look at the security for that point. Now, this is where I would, as a system manager, I would identify those Py identities that have permission to write to the data and permission to change the tag attributes. So now that we've done this, that we have one user or identity who has permission to write to all the tags that need to be written to, at that point, go back into your trusts and lock this down, or I shouldn't say lock it down, but make it more secure by saying, no, we're not going to give it, you know, this general complete access to everything. We're just giving it the same privileges as that user. And that user has permission to write to what that copy of buffering needs to write to. Now, to make this next point, let me go in and modify this briefly. I'm just going to change this so that it's going to the same IP address as the other trusts. And also, I'll get rid of that application name, and I'm going to make this kind of a, well, this isn't really a great thing to do. Let me go ahead and make this a user who has no privileges, PyDemo. This is an interesting problem. You could end up with a trust like this. It's just, you know, sitting around. Maybe for some reason somebody built this years ago. We've got a problem here. What if you have a connecting client that is showing us this information, this IP address, and it's coming from, well, it doesn't really matter where it's coming from, this BuffSS or the OPC interface, doesn't matter, because this trust right here is so liberal, you know, all it's requiring is that you come from that IP address. It doesn't even require that you have a specific application name. And what it's going to do is it's simply going to, you know, kind of mate you here to this Pi identity called Pi Demo. Well, that could be a problem, right? Because what you want is you want these incoming clients to have write access. Pi Demo doesn't have write access. So what do we do in the event that we have some kind of an ambiguous, you know, connection like this where it could actually match more than one trust? Now, see, any incoming client that's got this IP address of 204 is going to match to this trust. So that includes the ones that would also match this if they had a chance to match that. So how do we handle ambiguities like that where it can match more than one trust? Well, we've got a nice little table here that shows you that there's kind of a scoring that we do. Based on the incoming credentials, we assign a certain weight. So for example, the application name, if we can derive an application name and the application name matches, then we give that a weight of 163. Well, in this case, obviously, if you've got buffering coming in and we identify it as buffering, it's going to have a very heavy weight, you know, compared to just matching the IP address. In the case of this ambiguous situation where, let's say, buffering we're trying to connect from that IP address, the one trust would match with a score of 103. That's the one that just specified IP address and mates you to Pi Demo. But the one that specified application name and IP address would have 103 plus 163. It's obviously going to be a heavier weight. And so that's, you know, this specific trust, the more specific trust is the one that we're going to go with all the time because of that weight table.